He was a wealthy former football star.
Some people say he was blessed by God to be so athletically talented.
Whatever he did, he wanted to be the best at it.
She was an independent divorcee looking for a second chance at love.
Melody was a girl that knew what she wanted and how to get it.
Together, they fueled each other's wildest desires.
She was enjoying the sexual benefits of the relationship, and he was enjoying the same.
Until one day that flame is extinguished forever.
The only thoughts that came to my mind was, who would do something like that?
To me, it was like an assassination.
The crime sends police scrambling to track down a sophisticated killer.
The only reason to set a fire after the fact is to conceal and hide evidence.
What investigators find in the ashes is a twisted tale of wild sex, bold-faced lies, and cold-blooded murder.
Oh my gosh, it was incredible, the rumors that were out there.
We thought of him as this big, strong man. It was a shock.
He was murdered in a cruel and horrible way. The community demanded that there be justice.
Sylvania Township, Ohio, a middle-class suburb of Toledo. On the morning of July 4th, 2011, residents are getting ready for a perfect day of hot dogs, fireworks, friends, and family. But on Inland Drive, the smoke coming from one residence isn't coming from a backyard barbecue. It's coming from inside the house.
Fire department arrived. They could see smoke emanating from the house. There's flames and everything like that.
When firefighters are going into a house, their immediate focus is on, number one, fighting the fire, but also finding anybody who might be in the house alive.
The home is owned by 58-year-old L.C. Lyons, Jr. The team of firemen fight their way through the house, searching for L.C. along the way. They eventually reach the master bedroom. The entire room is ablaze, but through the thick smoke, they see a charred body lying on the bed.
I'm sure that when they initially came upon this person and saw his condition, you can pretty much tell that somebody has already hit the point of no return.
Firefighters continue battling the blaze. Meanwhile, Elsie's mother, Ella Brown, has arrived, having been contacted by the home security company.
This is my son's house. Okay. Is he okay? Where is he?
I don't have any information right now. Let me go ahead and get somebody that can help you out, okay? Stay tight right here, okay?
It had to have been a very traumatic situation for the family to see the house in flames, but you don't see your loved one. And so there must have been these agonizing minutes that stretched as you waited to find out, where is LC?
Ms. Brown, I regret to inform you that we did find a body of an adult male inside the home.
LC.
She took it very, very hard. I'm a mother myself, and I couldn't even imagine having to bury one of my children.
I'm sure that the initial feeling was, no way, this couldn't happen to him. Somebody always seems to come out on top.
He was an all-around good guy. Friendly, would speak to you, but you would never expect anything like this.
Born in 1953, L.C. Lyons, Jr. grew up in Toledo, Ohio. From the start, he was a person who looked out for others.
My mom was like his buddy. I'm the youngest, but that was her baby. He would take over a room with his personality. And his laughter and his, you know, he had so much joy, man.
A supremely gifted athlete, L.C. accepted a football scholarship to Ohio University, where he became a star running back.
L.C. Lyons had the potential to be a great Toledo success story. Some people say he was blessed by God to be so athletically talented, was a great football player at one of the local high schools here, wound up getting a football scholarship to one of the top universities in Ohio.
I remember a game when he played Kent State his senior year, and he rushed for like 158 yards for 41 carries, and that's still in the record books at OU.
What's more, L.C. placed second in the Mid-American Conference for rushing yards in 1974 and seemed destined for greatness.
There were many people who thought that he might have a very good opportunity to play in the National Football League, but for a variety of reasons, it just didn't work out for him.
Unfortunately, he was not drafted.
With his dreams of a career in the NFL over, L.C. returned to Toledo to start the second chapter of his life. He soon landed a job as a security guard, a far cry from the life of a pro football star he had imagined for himself.
He could have just been satisfied in this job working as a security guard, but it sounds like he was a little bit more motivated than most.
LC sacked away as much money as he could, then parlayed his savings into a successful wholesale clothing business.
He would go to New York, get clothes, bring back. He always brought back the good stuff.
He'd always have clothing at his house or in his car.
With his clothing business providing a steady stream of cash, LC began to dabble in real estate and quickly discovered he had a knack for it.
He figured out that he could make some money working in real estate, so he made a good amount of money flipping houses.
By the time he turned 40, this local football star-turned-real estate tycoon had earned a lot of money, but more importantly, a lot of respect.
If you needed anything, if you were down to your last, he would give you the shirt off his back. Everybody loved LC.
LC's kind heart, stout physique, and sizable bank account earned him the attention of more than a few eligible bachelorettes.
He never was alone, I'll tell you that. He had long-term relationships, but he never was married.
He was gonna always be LC.
But in recent years, friends had noticed that the lifelong bachelor had begun to yearn for something more meaningful. Then in early 2011, LC met 48-year-old Melody Williams. The two were instantly drawn to one another.
LC is attracted to beautiful women, obviously. And Melody was small, petite, she was fun-loving, and LC liked that about her.
And at 48 years old, Melody was closer in age to LC than most of the women he'd been dating.
Melody is a very good-looking woman who's in very good physical condition, very attractive. So you can see the connection that these two might have.
I'm LC.
Melody. Here's two attractive people who seem to take pretty good care of themselves and had similar interests.
Like LC, Melody was no slouch professionally. She'd retired early after a successful career at a nearby Chrysler Jeep auto plant.
Working at Jeep in Toledo is the job that you want. If you're from here, you get in your early 20s, you're out in your mid 40s, you have a retirement package, you have money saved up.
I think he saw in Melody someone that he could have a relationship with, but not necessarily have to support her financially.
As for Melody Williams, she was recently divorced and saw in LC a second chance at love.
Melody may have been at a point in her life where she was looking to find a man that might treat her, you know, a little bit better than the previous relationship that she was in.
And something else was pretty good too.
She was enjoying the sexual benefits of the relationship and he was enjoying the same.
These two people were coming into this relationship with a lot of physical attraction.
Chemistry in the bedroom wasn't all LC and Melody had going for them. There seemed to be a real emotional connection there as well. But on Independence Day 2011, LC and Melody's budding romance is tragically cut short. It starts when firefighters discover LC's badly charred remains inside his master bedroom.
So when they initially went into the house, they're obviously looking to see if anybody is alive in the house, but instead they find a large male inside of his bed, inside of the home. Of course, they don't know if it's his bed at the time, but they find a large male naked, lying in a pool of blood, and burned beyond recognition.
The police, they had a great question on their hand. Who was responsible for this? What kind of evidence can we get from this scene that might lead to whoever is responsible?
I think that it was because it was the 4th of July that maybe there was some thought that it was something maybe like a firework or something like that that had gone off.
Is this fire an accident or arson?
Fire officials said that several fires had been set throughout the house and that somebody had intentionally set the fire in the hopes of the entire house going down.
If this crime was arson, then what was the motive? And was LC the intended target? Or was the perpetrator after something else? When investigators finally learn the truth, it will stun everyone in this quiet Toledo suburb.
That really is an eye-opener because it's not something you expect in your community.
When he met the wealthy and beautiful Melody Williams, 58-year-old real estate mogul L.C. Lyons Jr. thought he'd finally met his perfect match.
It was a pretty intense relationship in the early stages. Here's two attractive people who seem to take pretty good care of themselves.
But only months into the relationship, their torrid romance was extinguished on July 4th, 2011, when firefighters arrived at Elsie's sprawling home and found him dead inside.
I was the on-call detective that day, so I got a phone call to come in because it wasn't what you'd see in a typical fire.
They discovered that there were actually five deliberate fires set inside this home.
After determining the number of fires the perpetrator set, investigators find a crucial, albeit unusual, clue. Green-tipped wooden matchsticks.
I've never heard anybody using green-tipped matches.
Hoping these unique matchsticks could ultimately help identify a suspect, investigators bag them as evidence. They also reach out to Elsie's family. Their goal, to better understand why someone would target his house for arson.
He was well-liked in the community. Elsie had a lot of friends.
He really did.
I don't personally know of any enemies that Elsie had.
The only motive the family can think of is theft.
I think it was a robbery.
Yes, it was a robbery. Elsie always
had to be a robbery.
Everyone always said that he had a very, very prized possession of his, which was a medallion of a lion head, and he always had that on.
It seems Elsie's favorite pendant is missing from the home. Could a thief have broken in the previous evening and then torched the home to destroy any evidence?
This was someone that was really intent on committing this robbery and was trying to figure out all the details to commit it.
That theory gains traction when Elsie's mother informs investigators that she noticed one of Elsie's cars, a gray Nissan, was missing from his driveway at the time of the fire.
When we found out it was missing, you know, we put out a bulletin to all area agencies, and that was pretty big.
So the police, they had a great question on their hands, what happened the night that Elsie died. What kind of evidence can we get from this scene that might lead to whoever is responsible?
After putting out an APB on Elsie's car, detectives returned to his home to further search for signs of robbery.
It wasn't uncommon for him to have, you know, $25,000 in cash sitting out. Allegedly, he had quite a bit of cash in the house, $16,000 cash plus the jewelry.
His jewelry and cash money was missing.
With every step, the robbery theory seems to be gaining credibility. There's just one problem.
His windows were locked. They had dust all over them. The doors were, you know, were locked. There was no signs of any forced entry.
It appears Elsie was in fact robbed, but the killer had no problem getting inside, which makes the position of Elsie's body at the time of the fire all the more curious.
He was in his bed naked when they found him.
If an intruder had entered Elsie's home, why was he still lying naked in bed? Had he been asleep when the perpetrator entered the house?
The only reason to set a fire after the fact is to conceal and hide evidence.
Part of that mystery is explained 2 days later on July 6th, when the coroner's office conducts an autopsy of Elsie's body.
They said that he had not died from smoke inhalation or from anything due to the fire, but the fact that he had been shot in the head.
We had heard that somebody actually had killed him, and we just couldn't even imagine who that could be. I don't personally know of any enemies that Elsie had. And it was just a hard thing to take.
If you have a murder case, there's more information you need, DNA evidence.
Unfortunately, the coroner is unable to salvage much evidence from Elsie's charred remains.
The fire was so extensive that it even caused significant damage to the bullet that penetrated the body.
They could only tell me what they thought, what kind of caliber it was, which was a .25 caliber.
Without physical evidence, it will be an uphill battle to identify Elsie's killer. Detectives begin that daunting task by attempting to determine the last person to see Elsie alive.
What do we got? Take a look at this.
We started looking at phone records immediately. Phone records showed, you know, that he had received a call the day before on July 3rd, 10:30 at nighttime.
A quick trace of the number leads detectives to Elsie's new girlfriend, Melody Williams. In the hours before Elsie died, the two had called and texted each other about getting together.
Melody texted him several times that night.
There was a series of text messages between Elsie and Melody indicating that the two wanted to hook up.
Detectives need to find out if Melody did indeed see Elsie the night of the murder. That evening, they interview her.
Understand it's been quite a bit of a day for you, so we'll keep this short. You could please just answer a few questions for us.
Clearly, these two had a connection very early on in their relationship.
Melody was attracted to Elsie, and he treated her really well, and she loved that attention that she got from him.
But Melody informs detectives there was more to the relationship than meets the eye.
Elsie had relationships with other women.
Melody knew about what he liked to do on the side, but she chose to be in that situation. If she chose to continue to stay in that situation, I don't see how she could be disgruntled, you know, because she's obviously getting what she needs.
Were you two together on the night of July the 3rd?
No. We talked about meeting up, but we never did.
Did he sound unusual, anxious, nervous on the phone when you spoke with him?
No. He sounded like himself. Elsie doesn't worry. Doesn't worry about anything.
Melody is unable to provide detectives with any leads as to who would kill her lover or why. But the fact that there are other women in Elsie's life creates a potential laundry list of suspects.
Police were looking at these other women. They had to figure out who of all the people in his sphere of influence could have done this to him. And the first obvious choice is a love interest.
Detectives decide to return to the crime scene, hoping to find clues that will lead them to one of Elsie's many lovers. But minutes into the search, they make a shocking discovery.
The police came across large amounts of cocaine, and naturally it changes everything when drugs are involved.
I found, you know, almost 200 grams of crack cocaine, which is that's a significant amount of crack.
It seems that Elsie Lyons Jr. had been harboring a secret, one that could have landed him in the crosshairs of some very bad circumstances.
The fact that the murder was covered by a fire, to me, it was like an assassination.
In the suburbs of Toledo, Ohio, athlete turned entrepreneur Elsie Lyons Jr. and his well-heeled lover, Melody Williams, shared a steamy, no-questions-asked relationship.
Elsie was a guy who liked to date a lot of women at the same time. He wanted to have his cake and eat it too.
So when Elsie is found inside his burned-out house with a bullet in his head, police suspect robbery was the motive. Until Melody Williams reveals that Elsie was seeing a few other women. Could one of them have found out about Melody and murdered Elsie out of jealousy? No sooner have investigators started entertaining that theory than they find a potentially game-changing piece of evidence.
They discovered a large quantity of crack cocaine inside the house, and this led some investigators to think there was possibly a drug motive to this case.
As investigators ask around, they're shocked to learn that Elsie was in fact dealing narcotics.
He was the go-to guy for crack cocaine in the city of Toledo. He made his own crack, and he supplied to other dealers who worked for him. He wasn't even on our radar. We didn't even know anything about him until after the fact, and then start talking to people.
But even those in town who knew Elsie was dealing drugs claimed the affable 58-year-old was anything but your stereotypical criminal.
While he may have been a drug dealer, he had other parts that people chose to focus on, chose to envision him as and look at him as, rather than sort of a seedy drug dealer. He managed to keep that impression out of the way people thought about him.
For most people, you think of the drug dealer as somebody who's standing on the street corner. You don't really think of someone living in the suburbs with a nice house and a nice car and nice jewelry. You don't really think of that person as someone who's dealing in drugs.
He dibbled and dabbed. He really wasn't like into the life, you know, because he had everything else going for him. He didn't want to really ruin it.
Regardless of Elsie's intentions, police know that Elsie's drug connections could certainly have exposed him to some hardened criminals.
Given the fact that he was involved in drugs, was he targeted by a rival drug dealer?
In fact, Elsie had expressed to some friends a fear that one such bad guy had targeted him for harassment.
There was one in particular guy that Elsie had told me about. It seemed like everywhere he went, the guy was there. You know, I don't think he was paranoid like that. Throughout the day, he'd look up and there was this guy.
Elsie's friends tell police that the man who'd been harassing him is one Leonard Armstrong, the other big supplier of cocaine in Toledo.
Leonard had it in for Elsie. There was some issues with drugs there, drug territory.
I think at one point, this guy appeared and had a revolver and let Elsie see it.
Elsie.
Hey, what's up, Leonard?
I've been seeing you around and everything, and, you know, just want to keep things cool, you know?
Yeah, we're cool.
And Elsie got back in his car and went on about his business, so that made him pretty paranoid.
Investigators can't help but wonder, had Leonard Armstrong made good on his threats to LC? Police track down Armstrong and bring him in for questioning.
Mr. Armstrong, I appreciate you coming in to speak with me.
Yeah, anything I can do to help.
Though Leonard skirts around his involvement in the local drug trade, he does acknowledge that he and LC had their fair share of disagreements in the past.
Did you ever threaten LC?
I know we didn't always see eye to eye on everything, but, you know, his business was his business.
Did you ever threaten LC? With a gun.
I mean, come on. There's a lot of posing and posturing goes on in our game, but nothing that serious.
Leonard was a dope boy, you know? He did a lot, but he never was like the murderer, you know, beating up nobody type guy, you know? All he wanted to do was make money and go home.
Maybe so, but detectives refused to take Leonard Armstrong's statement at face value. On July 15th, they subpoena his phone records, but find nothing placing him in the area of Elsie's house the night of the murder.
You know, when you started going through all the evidence, there was nothing there to link him to the crime.
With Leonard Armstrong all but ruled out, police are back to square one. None of the stolen jewelry has surfaced at area pawn shops, and there's still no sign of Elsie's missing vehicle.
We didn't have a whole lot of information at the time. We were kind of getting bits and pieces of information from people as they were getting it. And I don't know if it was because that they didn't want us to be upset, because the relationship that my husband Lamont had with LC, they were very, very close. I just think that they limited what they were giving us until they knew more.
Oh my gosh, it was incredible. The rumors that were out there and people calling saying, oh, you know, I heard that he was tied to the bed.
That he knew too much about somebody and they wanted to shut him up.
Allegedly, he had run-ins with some big-time drug dealers up in the city of Detroit.
There were rumors some gang had got him and pulled out all his teeth.
Police hear a lot of theories, but not one of them is backed by a shred of evidence.
It was just crazy stuff. I remember talking to his brother, Lamont, and right off the bat, he says, I know there had to have been a woman involved in this.
Detectives turn their attention back to Elsie's many girlfriends.
What's interesting in this case is he kind of had more than one girlfriend.
After compiling a list of Elsie's current and former lovers, detectives ask friends and family if any of the names stand out. One that keeps coming up is Gwen Wright.
She was the last girlfriend that Elsie had been with, and it was natural that investigators would look at her as a suspect.
We had kind of a love-hate relationship. When we loved, and when we fought, we fought.
Anytime you have a off-again, on-again relationship, and now that it's off, there's always concerns there that, you know, could this person have been angry or upset with this person and you know, want to do them harm.
It didn't take Gwen long to realize that from time to time, Elsie, he would have a wandering eye. He'd find himself being interested in other girls. That was kind of this sort of love-hate relationship that these two had. And what's also interesting is that not long before the fire started, Gwen was actually living in that house in Sylvania Township with Elsie. And so one of the things the police were looking at was, she jealous of any relationship that he may have been having with Melody?
And given the fact that Gwen lived with Elsie as recently as 2010, police believe it's entirely possible she still had keys to Elsie's house, which could explain the lack of forced entry at the crime scene.
That's a big key right there to show that, you know, he probably knows this person, because he's not going to let a stranger in.
At this point, detectives have one goal and one goal only: find Gwen Wright and bring her in for questioning. But when they do, they'll find out more than they ever bargained for.
I didn't trust anyone at that point. Friends he had for years and years, I just didn't know.
You know, you just kind of suspect of everybody.
In the suburbs of Toledo, Ohio, police are on the hunt for the killer of enigmatic businessman, LC Lyons Jr. To some, he was the friendly, teetotaling health nut who made a small fortune in real estate. To others, he was the former Lothario who made enemies in the drug game and in the bedroom.
A lot of people in his neighborhood were shocked. They had no idea that this man who had lived next to them for a number of years, mowed people's lawns, was involved in drugs.
But after ruling out the drug angle, investigators are focused on one of LC's many lovers, former live-in girlfriend, Gwen Wright.
They wanted to determine, was there a motive, a reason why she might have wanted him dead?
Investigators asked Gwen to come down to the station and question her about their relationship. According to Gwen, the biggest source of conflict in their decades-long affair was LC's roving eye.
It was never in my face, whatever he was doing with other women. He kept that from me.
Gwen kind of looked the other way, and she lived in that house with him for a while, and then, you know, things went rocky between them again, so she moved out.
Gwen tells police she and LC called it quits about a year ago. Just a few months later, LC began seeing Melody. Investigators can't help but wonder, did LC and Melody's budding romance prompt Gwen to murder LC in a fit of jealousy?
So I've got to ask, where were you on the night of July the 3rd?
It was on a Sunday. I was at home.
So you weren't at LC's house?
I told you, we were through.
So you didn't murder LC?
Absolutely not.
She was at home asleep when the fire happened. And for police, there isn't really a way to verify that kind of an alibi.
One thing that is verifiable is Gwen's grief over LC's death.
It was just like it wasn't even real. I just didn't know what to believe.
She had dated LC for a number of years. I know that she was always there for him and vice versa. So I think that they had a pretty close relationship.
Given Gwen's reaction to LC's death and the fact that there's no tangible evidence tying her to the crime, detectives change tactics and treat Gwen less like a suspect and more like someone whose intimate knowledge of LC can help them solve the case.
They were asking me personal things about how did he sleep? Did he sleep clothed?
Gwen had told us in her interview that LC always slept with his underwear on, always. The only time that he didn't have his underwear on is if he was gonna have sex. And sure enough, when he was found, he didn't have any underwear on at all, he was naked.
That information that she gave them kind of helped police realize that this may have been a murder that had a sexual motive to it.
But just as investigators wrap up their interview with Gwen Wright, they receive another break in the case.
LC's vehicle was found and recovered by Toledo police.
They got the vehicle. It's an apartment complex right off Franklin Bancroft area where he worked.
Found it parked, you know, in kind of a out-of-the-way spot.
When detectives look inside, it's almost deja vu.
It had attempted to be burned, but it didn't go up in flames. But what was left behind in that car was a pack of wooden green tip matches and a bottle of lighter fluid.
The green matches are identical to the ones found inside LC's home the night of the crime. But what's most striking is the car's location. It's in the neighborhood of LC's love interest, Melody Williams.
They found his vehicle not far away from where she lived. It's sort of a red flag.
Investigators ask LC's family what they know about LC's new lady.
I had never heard her name before. Just even in general conversation over the phone. Usually if he's kind of seriously dating someone, I had heard her name.
The odd thing was is that nobody in LC's family knew who Melody was. LC really didn't view Melody as a serious girlfriend.
Detectives decide it's time to pay the latest object of LC's affection another visit. This time around, Melody's not nearly as cooperative.
Second time she refused to answer any questions, period. That was when we did a search warrant at her house.
In the kitchen, detectives find something that seems to connect Melody to both the murder at LC's house and the destruction of his car.
What was key at that house was we found matches, those green tip matches. We found those at her house.
Wooden matchsticks are rather common, but the fact that the police found green-tipped matchsticks, that raised their interest.
The discovery of these matches seems to tie Melody to the murder. But when police subpoena her cell phone records, they'll begin to question everything they know about the case, about Melody, and about her connection to LC Lyons Jr. Successful businessman LC Lyons Jr. and his lover Melody Williams had a budding fling. cut short by Elsie's violent death. But when the same brand of matches used to torch Elsie's house and car are found in Melody's home, police begin to believe she may be the one responsible for his death. Further connecting Melody to the crime are the series of phone calls between them, which suggests the two met up the night of the crime in order to have sex, a theory further supported by the state of Elsie's body at the time of the murder.
All the evidence that was collected at the scene pointed at her.
Wanting to learn more about Melody, investigators perform a background check and discover Melody, like Elsie, was harboring some pretty big secrets.
A couple years prior, she was involved in a lawsuit against Chrysler. Chrysler did end up settling with her, and she walked away with a six-figure settlement.
She actually blew through the money in just a couple of years. And by the time she met Elsie, she was actually very broke.
I think for a lot of people, when they all of a sudden come into a lot of money, they spend wildly. And that's what she did here.
Investigators also discover an interesting text exchange that occurred the day after the murder between Melody and her ex-husband, James Wilson.
Melody had told her ex-husband, "You know what, I've got this business proposition for you."
Detectives think this business proposition was Melody's ploy to enlist James' help committing this crime in exchange for some quick cash.
She was sort of looking at Elsie as perhaps a meal ticket. So when Melody goes over to Elsie's house and she sees the jewelry lying on the dresser and all this cash laying about, she's realized, "I've just hit the jackpot."
Coincidentally, James Wilson has just been arrested by the ATF on charges involving illegal firearms. On July 22nd, James is questioned about his alleged role in the murder of Elsie Lyons.
When Elsie was murdered, he was robbed. Okay, and a lot of his was stolen. Mm-hmm. Okay, and we're looking for a lot of that stuff. Do you know where that stuff is at?
No, sir. Well, I would like to talk to my attorney before I keep answering questions.
James Wilson is unwilling to cooperate, but thankfully another individual has come forward with information. Melody's cousin, Justin Warren. Justin tells detectives that he thinks Melody might be involved in Elsie's murder, but he's cagey as to how he knows.
I know that she did it.
How do you know she did it?
She was there.
You know, I didn't know what to expect, and all of a sudden, he tells me I went to the house with her. He said that on the night of the 3rd, Melody showed up at his house.
Hey, Justin.
Hey, Melody, what are you doing?
I need your help.
What is wrong with you?
I need to know how you get rid of something.
Get rid of what?
How do you cover something up?
I guess the best way is to burn it. What's wrong?
Okay, come help me.
Then, according to Justin, Melody drove him over to Elsie's house.
He said he sat in the driveway while she went inside, and he said she was in there for, you know, a minute, and she come back out, and the house was on fire.
She gets into the car, and they drive off, and they throw the gun into the Mummy River, where it was never found.
Detectives are confident that Melody Williams is their killer. But with no murder weapon, no DNA evidence, and none of Elsie's jewelry having been recovered, Justin Warren's statement is not enough to bring charges.
Circumstantial evidence, they kept saying that they didn't want to try her too soon. We don't want something to come up later and we can't get a conviction.
Months pass with no arrest. Elsie's family worries his killer will never be brought to justice.
Detective Reddick told me it would be a while, And I said, I'm going to be patient because I know you're doing the best you can. And it got to be frustrating, but it was out of my hands.
I've seen this time and time again. Families get so frustrated with the police thinking that they're not doing anything when, in fact, they just sort of don't want to show all their cards because they feel like that might jeopardize the progress that they've already made in the case.
Meanwhile, it begins to really sink in that they'll never see their loved one again.
Elsie was always a role model for my husband. And I know that he loved him, more than a brother would love a brother.
Just the thought of living without my brother, it just, you know, it hit down hard. And it had me down and out for a while. I had to fight back hard to come back to be the man that he groomed me to be.
Then, in what can best be described as miraculous, a pair of investigators stumble upon the missing piece of evidence.
There came a point where some detectives with the Sylvania Township Police Department decided to take a trip to Detroit. Nothing work-related, but they were actually just going to go to the casino and hang out. And while they were there, they decided to go to a couple of the pawn shops. And to their astonishment, at one of the pawn shops, they found Elsie's missing lion's head pendant.
It's like finding a needle in a haystack. So they got all the records of the sale, and the sale of that lion's head pendant was by Melody's ex-husband.
Equally as damning is the date of the transaction. Less than 24 hours after Melody's text to her ex-husband about a business proposition. Finally, on October 11th, 2012, over a year after Elsie's remains were discovered, the Lucas County Grand Jury indicts Melody Williams on charges of aggravated murder, robbery, arson, and tampering with evidence.
It was a shock that it was a woman. It was a shock that it was a woman. Because we thought of him as this big, strong man, invincible, I guess is what we were all thinking. I think that it was a shock.
It was a sense of relief. When the arrest was made, we were happy.
We were pretty confident that they had captured the person that had done the crime.
But even behind bars, Melody Williams remains confident that she'll beat the charges against her. As they begin preparing for trial, Lucas County prosecutors have a gnawing feeling Melody might be right.
Her involvement in the arson could be established without much of a problem, but the murder was a very circumstantial case.
But not even Perry Mason could predict the bold gamble Melody was about to take, one that could make or break the case against her.
It was unusual. I think surprise or shock would be appropriate.
After a grueling 15-month investigation, police have charged Melody Williams with the murder of her lover, Elsie Lyons Jr. But with a lack of physical evidence connecting Melody to the murder, prosecutors decide to offer Melody a plea deal.
Prosecutors approached her with a plea deal. They would charge her with arson and theft and have her serve just 12 years in prison.
Despite the sweetheart deal, Melody refuses to play ball.
Melody felt very confident, so she turned it down.
But if Melody's decision to take the case to trial is surprising, what she does next is flat out jaw-dropping.
She fired her lawyer and decided to represent herself.
I was floored. I did not expect that at all.
The old saying is, if you represent yourself, you have a fool for a client. I wouldn't advise anybody to represent themselves.
However, those familiar with Melody's past and her ability to finagle a six-figure legal settlement aren't so sure she doesn't have another ace up her sleeve.
Melanie was convinced that she could win her case and be acquitted of these charges.
On March 4th, 2013, the case of the state of Ohio versus Melody Williams gets underway. In their opening statements, prosecutors present their theory that Melody Williams killed Elsie Lyons. The motive, they say, was money.
From what the evidence showed, she just wanted what he had, a little money, a little jewelry, whatever she could pick up around the house.
To support their claim, prosecutors point out the fact that Melody had blown through all of her settlement money and most of her retirement savings.
She had the money, she went through it and blew it, and now she has nothing again. She's back to nothing.
Prosecutors also claim that when Melody met Elsie, she saw the perfect target.
I'm sure that seeing somebody putting 30 grand down on the table, walking around with opulent jewelry, can sort of be tempting for somebody who's in a tough financial situation.
Prosecutors also point to the text messages between Melody and Elsie, which support the theory that she used sex to seduce him, then shot him after he fell asleep.
He falls asleep and got a 22 bullet put in his head.
After shooting Elsie, prosecutors say Melody took a bag of jewelry and $16,000 cash and fled the scene in Elsie's car.
So that, to me, sort of said that it wasn't a sort of heat-in-the-moment situation.
After laying out the scenario, the prosecution calls their star witness, Melody's cousin, Justin Warren. In exchange for immunity, Justin testifies that in the early morning hours of July 4th, Melody asked him for help.
Hey, I need your help with something.
She tells him, listen, I've done something really bad, and I gotta figure out what to do. And Justin sort of suggests that they burn the house to sort of cover up this crime. So while Justin is waiting in the driveway, Melody sets fire to the house.
According to Justin, after burning down Elsie's house, they drove to a pier 15 miles away on the Maumee River, where Melody dropped the gun into the murky depths. Finally, they lit Elsie's car on fire, though it never fully caught flame.
As it turns out, Justin proved to be a treasure trove of information for police in this case. He basically laid out exactly what happened that night.
To explain what happened after that, prosecutors submit the text exchange between Melody and James, as well as Elsie's lion's head pendant that James pawned in Detroit.
She was the mastermind behind the whole thing.
Prosecutors also bring up the unique green-tipped matches used to torch Elsie's house and car, which were also found in Melody's home.
I did some checking with the match company and found out that those green-tipped matches, they're sold in packs of eight. Well, you had the one pack found in his car, and we took seven packs out of her house. So you add that up, that's eight. Additionally, the matches were sold at a gas station or at a grocery store, you know, right around the corner from her house.
When it's time for her defense, Melody opens by explaining to the jury that she's no lawyer. Melody's choice to defend herself might seem crazy on the surface, but it becomes clear in her opening statements that she's thought long and hard about her defense strategy.
Melody raised some questions about some professional associates of LC. Basically, what she was trying to say was that it could have been some competing drug dealer.
According to Melody, several people had the motivation to want Elsie dead, including rival drug dealer Leonard Armstrong, or even Elsie's former live-in girlfriend, Gwen Wright. Melody even calls Gwen to the stand to publicly accuse her of the murder.
She's asking me, well, did you have a key? I said, yeah, I had a key. Like she wanted to throw me under the bus.
As for Justin Warren's testimony, Melody suggests her cousin could easily have robbed Elsie on his own and given the lion's head pendant to her ex-husband to pawn.
Well, Melody's main strategy in the courtroom was to raise doubt that not that she didn't do it, but that there was a possibility that someone else did.
It's a surprisingly effective strategy, one that prosecutors are careful not to attack too aggressively.
Here this woman is with no attorney, and we can't come across like we're the big bad prosecutors are beating her up, so that can really turn the jury off.
On March 8, 2013, after 4 days of testimony, Melody rests her case. As the jury adjourns for deliberations, she's confident they'll set her free.
She was convinced that she was gonna beat the charge and be released.
If the jury sort of bought the story that she was selling, that she was this innocent person, that she was perhaps being framed, that none of what the prosecution was saying was actually true, and if they liked her, then they might not like the prosecution if they felt like this person was being attacked. This person is innocent.
Melody's confidence is sorely misplaced. After just 90 minutes of deliberation, the jury finds Melody Williams guilty on all counts.
When the verdict was announced, we were relieved.
You know, just to be able to have some sort of closure.
If she needed money, all she had to do was ask. It's senseless why she did what she did. She had to be crazy.
The convicted killer shows no emotion.
She thought in her head that she could portray herself as being a sweet, likable person, intelligent, and I thought she thought she could sway the jurors in her favor. But that just kind of goes to show the egotistical part of her, and it backfired on her. I talked to the jurors afterwards, and the jurors did not like her. They did not like her at all.
The judge sentences Melody to a minimum of 59 years in prison.
Hindsight is 20/20. I'm sure if Melody had a second chance, she might take that offer presented to her by the prosecutors. They offered her 12 years. She wound up being sentenced to 59 years, which means she'll probably die in prison.
It's just amazing how quick, you know, you could be kicking it with a girl, and next thing you know, you're being bound and gagged, you know, because you thought it was love, but it was actually greed.
And while the whole sordid affair exposed a dark side to Elsie Lyons that few knew existed, the former football star turned beloved business icon is missed by many.
My heart, it's broken. You know, I'm brokenhearted. I am. That's the only man that can make me laugh.
He was bigger than life. A lot of people miss him. He's still here with us. Spirit, had a strong spirit. Yeah, he's still here with us.